All right, welcome. It's been a while and I've missed you guys quite a lot. I hope that you are well and staying safe. We're going to talk today about Chapter 6 of Gatsby, and I like to say that's where nothing really happens to advance the plot. I mean, things happen. We find out where Gatsby came from, and we get to go to more awkward parties, and we get to listen to a whole lot of beautiful prose, lyrical prose, but nothing really kind of moves the plot forward at this point. The first thing we do in Chapter 6 is we find out about Gatsby's past, and we find out that his name is James Gatz. He's from North Dakota, and when he was a young man, he basically about your age, he left home because he did not feel that his parents possessed the same capacity for dreaming that he did, and he had quite an imagination. And one day he meets up with a gentleman by the name of Dan Cody, as you know, and Dan Cody has money as well. It's new money, so that's kind of where Gatsby gets his education at first, when he learns about Dan Cody and how to be wealthy. Dan has a boat and he takes him under his wing, and they have a grand old time until Cody dies. And once Cody dies, he gets cheated out of the money he was supposed to have gotten from him. But before he dies, we kind of learn a little bit about how Gatsby kind of created himself. It says the truth was that Jay Gatsby of West Egg, Long Island, sprang from his platonic conception of himself. He kind of created himself through a dream that he had. He was a son of God, a phrase which, if it means anything, means just that. And he must be about his father's business, the service of a vast, vulgar, and meretricious beauty. There's this sense that he deserved to have more than he was born into. And meretricious, if you look up that word in your vocabulary sheet, because it's one of our words, it basically means kind of surface level, flashy facade on the outside, but then on the inside, there's just not really a whole lot of substance. So, and that's kind of what we're seeing with Gatsby, how he's kind of starting to manifest for us. It says, so he invented just the sort of Jay Gatsby that a 17-year-old would likely to invent. And to this conception, he was faithful to the end. Now, I mean, it's okay to have these great dreams and these great hopes and these great ideas and visions when you're 17. Maybe you're a little bit unrealistic about some of those things, but you know, Gatsby's in his 30s now, young man of 30. And it's, you know, things you hope that you would grow emotionally, and he kind of hasn't. He's kind of stalled here. Here's another example. When he met Dan Cody, this is kind of where he was at emotionally. And keep in mind, this is before Daisy ever came onto the scene, okay? It says, but his heart was in a constant turbulent riot. Now pay attention to the italicized and bolded and the colored words, because basically both of anything that's italicized or colored or bolded indicates either a dream. It's a word that kind of has to do with dreaming or conceptions. And then it kind of talks about what the effect of those are. Okay. But his heart was in a constant turbulent riot. The most grotesque and fantastic conceits haunted him in his bed at night. Each night he added to the pattern of his fancies until drowsiness closed down upon some vivid scene with an oblivious embrace. For a while, these reveries, that means dreams and hopes, provided an outlet for his imagination. They were a satisfactory hint of the unreality of reality, a promise that the rock of the world was founded securely on a fairy's wing. Now, think about what that means. A fairy's wing is probably very light, very delicate, and the rock of his world, like what he's building his foundations on for his life, are really, they're very being built on something very delicate, very transient, maybe something that's not going to be very strong. And that's kind of where he's going right now. That's what his dreams are focused on. This is all before Daisy came along. And when he meets Daisy, kind of everything culminates into a focus on her, and which is probably just as fleeting as what he's dreaming here, in that you really can't put all of your hopes and dreams onto one individual. He does that, and of course, it's not going too well for him. Here's an example of that. Gatsby's kind of a curiosity, kind of a talk about town. And so one day, Tom and his friends thought that they would go kind of check out this curiosity. And so they show up being kind of conceited and haughty and arrogant. All of those words are used in that section. And they meet Gatsby and they come to his house and they act like, you know, they care about him. And really all they want to do is sort of check him out, find out what this kind of crazy looking weird guy is doing every weekend. And unfortunately, Gatsby doesn't get it. He thinks, wow, they really like me. And he's like a kid in the schoolyard being picked to play kickball or something. And so he runs upstairs to grab his coat and hat to go to dinner with them on what was really a fake dinner invitation. And when he gets back, he realizes that they aren't waiting for him. And he says, hey, you know, where'd they go? And there's Nick again, looking incredibly awkward and thinking, wow, I have to be the one to tell him that they really didn't want to hang out with him. And he's kind of like, oh, buddy, you know, that wasn't what they were trying to say there. And Gatsby never really ends up fitting in to this old money world because he just doesn't know how to. Even Dan Cody's money was new money. So it creates this very awkward situation for him. Then he tries to bring Daisy into his world, that old money girl into his world, his dream into his world, and he throws a party. And Tom, you know, is there. And Daisy is there, and he's thinking, I'm going to show her my world. And he's like, what do you think, Daisy? And she says, nice party. And then he and Daisy kind of go off together and have their own little private party. And here's Nick again having to kind of lie for them to Tom. And Tom is over here kind of scoping out with his arrogant eyes. It says in the text, his arrogant eyes scan the crowd. And he's thinking to himself, wow, this is a really tacky party, but oh, there's some cute babes. I'm going to go, you know, at least have a good time. Because remember, Tom is not above having a good time with tacky people. He just, you know, he slums it for a while and then he goes back to his rich life. But then he realizes Daisy and Gatsby are gone and he starts to kind of catch on to possibly something happening. But we don't really get that thing to grow quite at this point in time. So we need to talk about Daisy's role. Is it the fulfillment of his dream that the rock of the world is founded securely on a fairy's wing? Or is it a barrier to it? And we get kind of a look at that when he was out with her when they were courting years before. And it says, now it was a cool night with that mysterious excitement in it, which comes at the two changes of the year. The quiet lights in the houses were humming out into the darkness, and there was a stir and bustle among the stars. So you've got this kind of juxtaposition between darkness and the stars, the light of the stars. And so Gatsby's kind of has to choose between these two worlds. Is Daisy going to be the culmination of his dream, or is he going to leave her behind and continue to search for his dream? And we find out he stays with her. He makes her his dream. Out of the corner of his eye, Gatsby saw that the blocks of the sidewalk really formed a ladder and mounted to a secret place above the trees. He could climb to it. That's him continuing on in pursuit of his dreams in the way that he really probably should have. That was the road he should have taken, the ladder he should have climbed. And I said, if he climbed alone and once there, he could suck on the pap of life and gulp down the incomparable milk of wonder. Sorry, there's a typo there too. But he chooses not to do that. He chooses not to go at it alone. And that kind of becomes his downfall at this point. There's the ladder and he doesn't take it. So this continues on. It says he knew that when he kissed this girl and forever wed his unutterable visions to her perishable breath, his mind would never romp again like the mind of God. And if you remember all the way back to the beginning of the chapter when it said he was the son of God. And so it's basically he's giving up his unformed dreams from back when he was 17 for this woman, thinking, unfortunately, thinking that she's going to be the answer, and she's not. So it says, forever wed his unutterable visions to her perishable breath. His mind would never romp again like the mind of God. So he waited, listening for a moment longer to the tuning fork that had been struck upon a star. I think that's such beautiful language there. The tuning fork that had been struck upon a star. And then it says he kissed her. And it's almost this anticlimactic moment, this dun dun dun, because that's kind of where his dream begins to die when he kisses Daisy. And it's not this wonderful moment that that he thinks it's going to be, and we'll find that later. So what's next? Well, you need to read chapter 7. You need to continue working with your study guide questions, because I really do think that they help you understand what's going on and keep you kind of focused on the important elements of each chapter. And I want you to buckle up, because the ride's going to be bumpy. Things are going to heat up in chapter 8. Look for a lot of words that mean heat and hot, and think about what that could bring up for us. So thanks for listening, guys. Hopefully we'll be together soon. If not, we'll try to do another one of these deals, and take care and be safe. Thank you.